basically went round the full workshop, mentioned a package called Kitematic, which you'll need to install on your machines, and we've lost video. Right. So that's what we'll be using to deploy Docker containers, which are the training environments I'm going to show you that we've been using to get people to engage with Docker, albeit without them really knowing. So if I go back to... So I thought that was a really sort of sexy title, you know, put the word Trojan horse in. And it is true. Certainly, I think you wouldn't be here if you weren't keen about containers and getting people to adopt them within their daily work and as a means to an end. So we need to think about getting people there. So that's the big question. How do we convince people to use containers? Now, there's a variety of ways that we could go about this, some more successful than others. The first one, I hopefully don't do that, but you can over egg it. You can, you should be using containers, they're absolutely brilliant. You know, you've solved all your problems, you know, your washes will never be whiter. The only trouble is that, like the pointed boss, it's Zuz time. Sometimes full-blown evangelism about an idea is not the way to go. People turn off. So, and also you tend to be quite forceful when you turn up, people tend to back away. Here's another scenario you've probably come across when people want to show off their software. You book a room, you advertise it, put your posters out, put it on the intranet, you say, come along, we'll show you some really interesting stuff that will really help your work. Now, point number one, will it automatically be classified into nerd stuff? I'm a biologist, I don't do this stuff. Word processors and spreadsheets is all I want to get while I do my work. And that's tied into the second point about how to make containers relevant to your audience. You know, why do they want to use it? Not why do you want them to use it, but why do they want to use it? And a key aid is, this is a very passive demo, you notice. Everyone clustered around the laptop. Oh, isn't that good? Actually, what they really want to be doing is they want to sit down at that machine, start playing with that tool, and see what it can do. You know, let's pop the hood and see what's on here, what foundation it's got. And how do they learn to use that tool? Because there will be an activation energy. Got to get past, how do I get going with Docker? How do I get this running on my machine? You know, what's out there? And you've got to get them past that point. If you get past that point, it's a lot more easy for them to start adopting the use of containers. So, you kind of what I got from the talk yesterday. I do biomechanics training. Which gives me a little handy in. So let's get them doing something that's got immediate value to your audience. Okay? Let's show them containers helping them to actually get to what they want to do. And let's demonstrate the tools in a way that's actually easy to use. By easy to use, I love the command line as much as anyone, but if you take a neophyte and stick them in front of a command line, it doesn't usually end well. So, here we go. So we start putting up, hey, come on to some biomechanics training. You know, we've got a session coming up. we're going to do this topic, etc. Don't tell them they're using containers, okay? And the thing is that, people, when they want to learn, will take on all sorts of new ways of doing it. I mentioned yesterday flipped classrooms, you know, where people go off and do the exercise, you know, go and do the material outside and come back. People do that. The classic, you know, who's not been on a course where you've had an ice-breaking session, where you do some silly task and explain yourself to your peers? That people will take on board different approaches to teaching. And if you package this, so this is the way we are going to teach you something useful, you're far more likely to get them to accept it. So, okay. Does everyone here use containers now? Yeah? Okay, there's a few shaking heads. Okay, well, let's give the people who are shaking their heads the reasons why. So if we were trying to introduce containers to an audience, what aspects would we like to communicate? Anyone? Just straight to the audience. Anyone? Don't think they could immediately lay hands on?
Portability.
Say?
Portability.
Portability, yeah. So can I run it on my Mac? It's probably the usual question you might come across. I see a few Macs in the audience. Good news is, yes you can. Any others? Okay. How about it's not going to mess up my software or my machine? This is my computer. I don't want you messing it. Okay? That's another positive aspect. And we kind of had some of that in some of the other talks where you've got this problem with versioning. And we've gotten away from the bad old days of DLL that we used to have in Windows, where you'd have different versions for the dynamic libraries that would then cause grief with other applications. But there are still aspects, especially where you've got libraries that are supporting particular applications, especially in Linux. You don't really want to mess with someone's setup. This is their work tool. You do not mess with it. End it. So, another one might be, how long does it take to put software on my machine? You know, is it going to take a long time? And as I hinted yesterday, when we used VMs, it was like watching paint dry. People copied the VM off of the server onto their laptops that they're using and to get it working. And then it was, oh my God, how much memory is that using up? How much disk space is that using up? You know, on a poor machine. There is this thing that it's not going to mess their machines. That is a very common worry. If this is someone's livelihood, this is the work they do with data. If you've come along with a wondrous new toy and trashed their machine, they're not going to be pleased. So you have to reassure them that this is not going to happen. Another one is convenience. I mentioned the App Store and Google Play. People are used to those now. It's common sort of practice to go and load apps onto their phone. If you can give them an environment where it's just like that to pull down their computational environments, again, that's an easy sell. So, has everyone got Pragmatic installed? That's the first question I need to ask at this point. If not, we'll get the URLs are there, and well, I think they're also in the original notes.
We can use it through Linux.
Yes, we can. It's a little bit more involved. What you'll do is sort of Docker engine, and you'll run from the command line. That hasn't got a GUI.
I couldn't install it. They wouldn't play together, I've tried.
Yeah, okay. There is a gotcha. Kitematic originally was developed on the Mac, and Docker bought them because they saw this and thought, yes, this is the way of getting our containers add to the masses. It relies on VirtualBox underneath with a Coros VM, so I always say a wafer thin VM, as little minimal as you can get. What the thing I've found is there are a multitude of versions of VirtualBox out there. They do lots of little versions, and I think part of it might be Oracle involved. If you've ever used Oracle products, you're used to their version numbering system going on, you know, for a page. So they do pump out lots of versions. I have found some versions do not play nice. It's sad, but that's the way it is. I'll tell you that if you've got VirtualBox, if you can fire it up, it'll take a few minutes. As you saw in mine, the first thing it does is generate this little VM, and you get the circle going around. If all goes well, you'll get to 100% and it'll come up. There are some issues with some issues where it gets about 99% and just sits there forever. I've tended not to go for the latest version of Kinematic on our training machines, because I tend to stick, if I know it works, I'll stay at the version if there's no major advantage. So we've got a... I've got some output here that I'll screen grab. So when somebody launches this, first thing you notice, obviously, it's a nice GUI environment. It's got things that wouldn't be out of place in a web browser. There's a search bar. It's got little cogs for settings, things like that. Things that people who are coming from a Windows or Mac GUI environment expect. Okay. And if you go onto the search bar up here and start typing, it will automatically start restricting the search space. It'll start listing containers that match what you've typed in so far. Obviously, you know, that if you're unfortunate, you might roll one of a lot. If you choose a different place, then you're going to have to explore. I'll show you that in a minute, how you can do that. One I'm going to suggest is, if you're going to load it, is just try this one. So it's ngs_intro. This is something that I adopted. I came across a project where they were using Raspberry Pis to teach mathematics, which is all well and good, and I looked into setting up a lab of Raspberry Pis, but I felt that it really didn't fit into what we want to achieve with our byte sizing. So I took the environment, changed the ARM binaries for i86 binaries, and built a clock container to actually deliver the material and all the tools. So that's what that one's about. It's a simple thing. It lets people use some commonly used tools like SAM tools, so they're dealing with alignments to reference sequences. Very common activity. It was a nice, gentle way. Having brutalized a few of them with the command line previously, I thought it'd be nice to them and actually give them something that was really focused on what they wanted to do. So I need to just switch. Right, so that's the full pane. By default, yes, there are a lot of containers. Well, there are a lot of containers in .hub. There's our search bar. That's some containers that I've already pulled down from the machine. Usual Docker benefits that you can point out at your leisure. And as you say, it after you've done the important material that you're trying to say. But obviously, you've already loaded some layers. So when they pull tonic depending upon those layers, it'll be faster loading into the machine. So if I start typing, you'll see that it will actually limit the choices once I start putting in a search step. So it's quite responsive and interactive. If you have to save and delete it, delete a character and go back, things like that. It's quite easy to use. So, and you'll notice that there's a create button. What that does is it will pull the container into Pymax and onto that little core OS for the end. There are all sorts of other indicators. So there's things about the number of pulls of a container, whether or not people have started it, you know, say, yeah, I like this. Feedback's always interesting. And as I said, you might not know what a particular container is. So you can actually get to open a browser to the hub. Okay, so here that's taken straight to Docker Hub, and we then have information about the container that I've set up. It's got, if you want to do it from the Docker engine, of course Docker Hub tells you what you need on the Linux side, but obviously with Pymax we don't do that, we've got our own way of doing it on that GUI. And you can find out a bit more about the project, so you can, I'm always a good boy, I'm always a good dog bar. And I also always put up my GitHub, so this is the bit I don't like.
This is where you see where I've messed up.
When I've been doing builds and Docker Hub, so obviously it doesn't always go to plan, so you have the old failed build. Joy's continuous integration. But people get an idea, you know, like when did he last update that particular container? This was at the very early days of our program, so I haven't done much of it. I am going to go back to it because there are lessons learned. Source repository. So again, then go across to GitHub and see what went into building that container. So it's not a black box. It's very much not a black box. So again, this is another way of reassuring people what they're actually getting when they're pulling these containers. So click and create, it connects Docker Hub and starts pulling. And this sort of toaster showed below. If anyone can ever explain to me what it's actually trying to tell me, I'll be very grateful. I just need to, I've been quite happy with the progress bar, to be honest. But the toaster doesn't seem to make any see.
On the Linux, there are about four layers that it can be down, so it could be those different layers.
Yeah, it could be, but there are, I know there's a lot of these containers have got more than that. And if you go back to the build log, you'll see the layers that we pull. I think it's meant to sort of conceptually sort of think I'm pulling layers, but I'm not sold. So basically, it'll pull that down, and it's always interesting when you do this on Wi-Fi, because if you get a lot of people doing it all at once, it can get slow, but it's still quicker than trying to copy a 12 gig VM, I promise you that. So on that screen, we've got a variety of other features. Most of the features that you would actually use in the command line when mounting a Docker container are available to the user. It's just nicely packaged. Yeah, there's plenty of time to get them into doing it from a Linux card line. I mean, you don't want to rush. You want to hit the CC benefits first. So, volumes. So if you declare volumes in your Docker file, it lists them here. And by clicking on them, you can then use that to map to your local hard disk, so you get the writable directories rather than that thin top layer. Don't ever use that top layer, of course, especially in bioinformatics, you will rapidly fill that. It doesn't take much. And as I said, yeah, the cogwheel will tell you where it's mapped. If you've done a mapping and you've forgotten where the files have gone, you can get back to it. It's quite easy. Another feature of Docker that you want to present, in fact, that, you know, we've actually got a nice reminder about the ports. And people are used to using web services and using ports on their URLs. It's always nice to know what port you're meant to be connecting to. And it's pulled out. So these are the allows. And this is the area where I have a bit of intention with Guidematic. If you're on a Windows machine, you can't use the normal copy and delete. You can't delete and insert. You have to use Control-C, Control-V, back to the good old Word style days. And what you wind up doing is, so this is exposing port for shell in the box. Has anyone come across shell in the box? No? Okay, well, interesting, you can see it, something. So we want to connect to that to use it with the course material. So we need to Control C, go into a web browser, and Control V to paste it into the URL. Should then take it to that. But basically, that's what that's telling people about. There is a difference. There is another one thing where you're using a conventional web port like 80. It will do a web preview. You can click on it, and we'll do one of those later on. This is just that. That's one of the irritating things I'm trying to show people at the beginning. Right. Just back to the laptop. So it's loaded. All of those things that I've mentioned are there. So we've got our container list down here. That's the current container we're on. We have tools for deleting those containers. So if you wander over it, you get a nice big cross of death, which you can use to delete the container, and then get a dialogue of whether or not you want to actually delete all the files because the layers. Up here, we have the controls for the current container. So you can stop a container, you can restart it. If it's not executed, you can start it. You can go into a shell into that container using that exec. So that's the sort of normal sort of TTY in. So it'll, on Windows, it'll do a PowerShell login. So you'll be in a PowerShell, you can connect to that container. I'm not sure about the Mac, I have to say. I presume it'll be one of the terminals available. And that's basically a link across to the Docker Hub docs again. So if you forget, you can just click on that and it'll show up on the page. If you've got one with a web preview, if you've got a container that's got a web preview, there'll be a little extra thing up here to press on. But we've only got these ports, that's all I've exposed. Okay? The other thing you'll find about those of you who are trying, if you think about the life cycle of a container, you've got this one process up here. When that process dies, the container dies. Gone. Which is all well and good, but if you want to run a web server with services, etc., obviously you use Supervisor. And Supervisor becomes your one process, and it then defers to all the other things you're running. So what we've got, if I draw C, and yes, I'm very messy with my work. A lot of tabs. If I control B, this is shell in a box. So basically, it's a terminal in a web browser, and it's just a very simple way of getting across. The user, the learner doesn't have to use things like Putty or anything like that to get into that container. So it just removes them. I mean, yes, you will have to show them, but not now. So if you manage to get that one up, the part, the username and password is guest. Incredibly insecure, I know. So we've got effectively a full sort of terminal into this container. I usually sort of customise the messages of the day to let them know what they've actually connected to, any relevant references back, acknowledgements to, etc. And I do warn them about this business about mapping. And it is a negative point to users when they come in. So why isn't it done all time before? Well, it wasn't a chooser directory, etc. So you have to break it to them that this is something they get used to doing. It's harder the first time you do it, but subsequent containers they get quite used to. So, as I said, it's using shell in the box. I presume these are going to go up on the conference website at some point. So, if not, email me. I'll happily mail that to you. And there's a link off to shell in the box project, which is it's quite a nice project. It's your IT people will probably go. Because you do actually, if you want to use this seriously in an outward-facing environment, you do take steps to secure it. Because obviously, you're providing a web port straight into a Unix machine. But you can do things like change port numbers and have extra layers of authentication. But for a training environment, that's going to disappear. Not really. So if we can get you into that, what I've got is a set of notes that are actually in PDF format. Because we're in a command line, might be start to say, well, how are you going to do that? On Kitematic, if we click on, I've told the users what they should do, but I've not done it. So that should. Tell me where's the map that to. So, so I've clicked on the gear wheel about the volumes, and light blue and white is probably not the most readable thing that they've chosen. So that's pointing to a mapped directory. I don't know again on MacOS where it actually puts that. I mean, I should actually ask some of my pupils because they have all the log.
In your documents folder.
Right, brilliant. In Windows, it has to be under the C users tree. I think, I think that's to do with VirtualBox. It's some VirtualBox is imposed rather than Pragmatic. I can see there we've not assigned folders to those other shared logs, so they are the internal directories on that container.
It's pretty much the same.
Yeah, this is one of the things, it does look the same. I've had people attending a course side by side, Mac and PC, and it looks pretty much the same. But to the user, it's a very common experience. And it makes it easier when you're doing notes as well for a course, because you can just do screen grabs and it just looks like what they're getting. You're not going to put multiple versions in. That soon wears thin when you're doing track notes. So, the gear wheel down there that lets you into the volumes. Probably way ahead of you start clicking on some of those. So the other thing that they have to get used to is that they're going to have to copy files that they're going to work on and save into that directory. And usually I'll do something like using a shell script. Breaks that connection to the container because it's made it take the container down, it's brought it back up again. It's a pain, but if you were doing this in the command line, you'd have the same thing. If you hadn't enabled the volume and you wanted to add it, you have to do G recovery to get it to it. Again, when we were on that panel where we had that horrible light blue on white path, you can actually go in and look at that directory. It'll take you through the, in the case of Windows, it's a normal file explorer. Again, the equipment on the Mac. Within using the host OS, it's what the user is familiar with. So, overall, that's a good thing. Let's shove a lot from a directory in the container that's not got a lot of space into a directory that's mapped on the hard disk of the laptop or the desktop machine, whichever they're using. And if I go back into Pragmatic and cross home.
There we've got
the material, and again, to try and be kind to them, having put them into the command line environment, they can now use their host OS to look at the PDFs. People put the course together actually quite a nice set of things. They did a couple of sort of newbie guides, so just a beginner's guide to Unix command line. And a bit about text editing. We've never really used those in our courses because we have another unit using another Docker volume called Linux Command Line Bootcamp, which is a web intro to Command Line. But it's there. So if they weren't learning from home or whatever, and they're thinking, oh, I just don't know what to do here, they have got these.
So I can get that to work. It says home guest, no such file or directory.
Right.
So I don't know if anybody else has.
So have you mapped the volume yet?
I mean, the home thing is it's actually not going to home guest.
Yeah.
Got to home.
Where are you? Do you do it from where it looked like, from the actual
top level?
Top level, yeah. Just see if...
Okay, so a bit of that. They can't. There's nothing good.
Okay, I'll come back to it.
Other people may be okay, but it might just be me.
Okay. This is the joy of live demos. So, the one that actually introduces the course is this one.
Set A, failure of the Raspberry Pi,
which didn't really suit our environment.
And they had a whole, they take people through, so we're doing alignments, producing these alignment files and we use the SAM format. We want to turn it to BAM, we want to index it, we want to align it to a reference. So all of that sort of core stuff, people who are doing bioinformatics, is there. What I also provide with them in GitHub is I actually did a walkthrough. So come on my session and see everything that's in there. And I actually added a few things to actually try and make the commands easier as well. So there are things where they don't have to do directories anymore. There are links, soft links to things. And so basically they've got a complete walk through. As ever, I encourage people when they're doing materials, don't just stick to the walkthrough, try a few things. What happens if I change this parameter? Sometimes that leads to a bit more technical support required, but it's a very good way of getting them to actually interact with the tools. And as far as we're concerned within this workshop, the person is actually interacting with a container. So 5 minutes ago, they didn't have a Linux environment on their machine. They've now got one. So instantly, you see that container's in it. And they know it's not, other than the directory they've mounted to store their files in, which they would do with any other application they've installed on their host OS. So again, it's just like a program on their machine. It's not affecting any of their other software. They can go back in and they're using other tools like the PDF viewers. So they're actually interacting with it. And you're starting to introduce a lot of the concepts and terminology about containers. So they're getting the idea about, you control ports into a container. So it's for those who are concerned about security, they immediately know that those ports are actually open on that container. Only those ports are open on that container. So you start to get the thinking in that way. So if at the end of the long journey they want to actually produce their own Docker files and build containers, they've already been introduced to the concepts of what they're going to think about when they're designing. So, like what mount points am I going to have for my volumes? What ports am I opening? What user are they going to be? All sort of very basic stuff, but you actually need to know that before you start plowing into a Docker file. Things like cost VC, which gives you an idea of the quality of the sequence data. Don't panic, this bit is, I apologize to any bioinformaticians in the world, this is fairly normal. The quality just tails off as you get a lot longer and further along the sequence. The tools generate web pages, which they can view in their web browser on the host. So again, they know that the container's there, it's doing its job, but they're still using their own machine, all that's still working.
So, and I have had people go from trying, they're quite happy to try and use this on look, doing a first look at their real data because they've got the software installed in their machine now. So hopefully you can see again, this is quite an upbeat way of selling containers. You can actually show that there's value to it. That's the first thing we need to prove to them. We need to show them that it lives in isolation. That's one of the big things about containers. That we have control on the security front, so because people will worry about their IT people bashing them. They know where to look. They load the container. They know where to look to see what ports it's opening as well. They've used one container. And that particular container's got excuse me, things to actually show them what's been opened up. And the other thing is that when they're doing, they're using this particular one, so they're generating alignments, they've got summary statistics from their sequences. It's actually available to them on the Windows or the Mac side. So literally on the Mac side, they'll go to that directory, they'll bring things into Word or whatever tools they want to use. So it's integrated into their work environment. So they've got the tool to do the analysis, and then they've got the tool to do the reporting that they normally use. So it just puts us up there, the container is just an app. okay, right. So is everyone happy with that as an intro to the tools of the trade? I should say that, I mean, Pragmatic itself, I think is a bit of a dead end because now we have Docker for Windows and Docker for Mac, which actually are a lot more native, closer to the OSs. The reason I went down the Pragmatic route rather than going for that is down to our Windows machines and our site. Now, I don't know what about your particular home institutions, but have you all gone over to Windows 10 on every single machine? No? Yes? So we've got a lot of Windows 7 machines still there. And IT are gradually getting their way around. But it takes time. There's inevitably going to be problems. So what I wanted was a tool that would run on all the machines that we currently have. I wanted it to be the same tool. Because if you're doing a training course, if you've got more than one way of launching containers, it's going to cause confusion. People are not going to know which bit of this instruction relates to me, which bit relates to my main Mac. So I sat there, and the thing that really gutted me, I started playing with Docker for Windows on the Windows 10 machine, and there was this realization that it's a one-way journey. Because of what you do to enable the hypervisor for the Docker for Windows, it means you can no longer run VirtualBox. And I can think that might be a bit of a deal killer for a lot of people, because if you're already using VMs and VirtualBox, you aren't going to want to go there. I don't know whether they'll change it, I guess they're going to wait for feedback. So it meant that if I had a Windows 10 machine, and I set it up to run with Docker for Windows, I couldn't easily flip back to VirtualBox. So I'm waiting. Except that there's a significant majority, better than Mrs. Mays, on our machines as far as Windows 10 is concerned, then I'll take them across. And Yeah, so we'll probably die away from that. But as a tool, it's quite good. It's a good way of introducing people to the aspects of containers. So again, if you're trying to sell containers in your organisation, it's quite a nice way of doing it. Is everyone happy about it? I mean, you're actually giving people a nice command line interface. It's in a web browser. They use web browsers every day. So if they haven't used Putty, they haven't used other terminal tools to connect to a Unix box, you just take that away for a moment. They're just concentrating on what they're going to get out of this particular goal. Any questions about that? As far as about how it's actually running.
The PDF files, the docs directory had a bit to be in my course, because I missed something.
That script that you copy, that script that you run, copies from the guest home and sticks it into the course.
The script that I missed running,
But it just means that it's in the writable volume, so. They've got it all in one place. I like having structures. I like having directory structures with data and docs and so on. I like trying to get them to good practices early on. Because we've got some people who are, they've never done this kind of thing before. And you really have to hammer it home about if you do not structure your work environment, it will come back and bite you. It will bite you. And it'll bite you big time on something you spent a lot of money on getting sequences, for example. So we need to get them to good practice. So I build the directories like that. But I didn't want to, I wanted them to know where it was. That's a nice thing about having that course home. I could have had several volumes. I could have had data, I could have had docs, and so on. But in this instance, because I'm dealing with beginners in a lot of the cases, I stuck it all in one directory and built a tree down. It's partly a life lesson for them as well, as I said, about being good about how they store their files. But it also is partly just to make it easier to find things. Right. Okay. So, as I said, that's a very simple container. If you go to the GitHub, you'll find all of those areas. There's a few of those. We've done a variety of shell-based ones because we wanted to get people into using the shell. We do have alternatives. Has anyone heard of the Galaxy project? Yeah, it's a web-based bioinformatics tool. It puts a web wrapper around all the command line tools. So again, for those who are command line phobics, they can get to it. However, it's good for certain types of analysis, but you are limited by the wrapper that's been put around that tool as to the tool functionality that you can access. So things that you could do from the command line with the flags, not all of those may be available to you in Galaxy. So we try to show people the command line in preference. I mean, we do show people with other tools like Galaxy as well, but we like to get them into the command line because you've got the same thing of people building pipelines and having automation. And also, if they go onto an HPC, you aren't going to find the Galaxy running on that. You might have a Galaxy server that submits jobs, but it won't be on there. So if they're doing that kind of thing, you need to teach the command line versions. And this is nice, they've got the whole thing, they've got only the tools. If you look at the docker file, you'll see that I've really trimmed it down. Get to the docs. So, look at the docker file. It's actually not that. So
Again, I think I mentioned yesterday that as a trainer, it's nice to have a common start point. So I build a basic container which has got specific ports and volumes set up, and then I build more layers. And again, if you want to actually get people into writing Docker files and they've been on your course, you say, right, here's the Docker file for this course, now go and add something else onto that. So they've already got a template here of the kind of things you do. You inherit someone else's good hard work up here, and you add your particular goodness to it. So again, they can see an immediate reward from the changes that you can build on what's been done before. Probably by somebody who knows how to do it well as well. A lot of these tools, you know, you come to it cold, it can take you a very long time to get the right configuration and get it working. I mentioned Shine yesterday. That is a learning experience from software installers. If you want to get everything working, it is very normal. And if they've come, if you've taught them, we've just recently done a course on installs, so they start to learn things like apt-get, yum, pip, make, all of those sorts of approaches to software installation. So they are at least familiar with the ways in which software can be installed and brewed, sorry, not brewed, how software can be installed. So at that point, you give them an intro into Docker file, so they can see what that's doing. You might explain a few things. You can show that you can bring scripts in and GitHub. So, you know, how many people create Docker files regularly? Did you learn a lot from looking at other people's Docker files? Any tricks? Because I find it a worthwhile source. If you haven't started building Docker containers, go to the Docker Hub and pull a few of these. I mean, your mileage may vary. It's a bit like GitHub. Some of the projects are only half finished, some of them don't work. But the ones that do work, you pull them in, try them, and know that they work. Go back, and if they've been good boys and girls, and actually put the Docker file up on the Hub. That's it. I think there was a speaker yesterday who pointed this problem out, that sometimes people don't go the distance. They don't put the documentation up about how the container was built and what version they use, etc. That kind of just ruins the deal for me. So I think for all my containers, I've put the Docker file and the appropriate tools I've used back on GitHub. So people can take my stuff apart and build it better. So if they've done apt-get in one of our courses, they'll immediately say, oh, I know what that's doing. These are the tools, so these are our sequence aligners, web tool, all files, Java, the quality control program, bit of Git. I didn't show them Git as well. Only they think they know that's it. It's a couple of things that I pick up tools, things like the other side of the program. Things to generate PDFs, sound tools, etc. So it's a very good way if you actually want to go on further and teach. If you've got some containers that you taught people other tools in, you can then take them into that tool and actually show them. I really cannot undersell that. It's such a nice way of doing it. You can actually, again, start to give them good practice. I've got a few bad practices in here, this bit, so I found them not worked. I tried out and I then removed. please don't take that personally, F1000 research. I just had trouble pulling because things moved in the website. All good stuff. The fact that you can get to these teams. Double plus. Right, okay, back to me. Do
Do you want to go? I mean, just, are you happy? I'm conscious of time. I think we've got coffee at 10:30. I'm never standing about anyone's coffee.
So, basically, you know, you go over and have a go at this. And it's all, that's the other thing that the learners get, is that they've got control. This isn't a machine that they need to have access to. So it doesn't matter if they're on our site, but often you find that the IT group, if you're off site, will let you VPN in, but they'll only let you use certain ports and so on. There's some restrictions on you. And that can make it harder to access some of the resources like HPC, etc. But they can be at home, just fire up the version of Pragmatic on their home PC, pull the container, carry on learning. And again, that's another thing to tell them, you know, that these things are available to them wherever they are, on whatever machine they're on, if they've got a network connection, bingo. And that's the other thing as well, that you haven't got this software, for every subsequent container, you haven't got this business of installing and configuring software on the machine. Some of these packages, especially the bar packages, are involved. They've often got a lot of dependencies. And if somebody's only just started learning how to install packages on their Linux environment, that can be a big hurdle to them. Things fall down with the dependency, and then they've got to trace back. And I have to say that some of the documentation out there for installation really sucks. You'll get crypto errors, and you have to go to Google to find out, oh right, they actually expected you to have this particular library on your machine. Again, I think one of the speakers yesterday pointed this out, the assumptions that are made for a lot of software about what's actually going to be provided in the computer environment. I think it was the chapter with the singularity containers, the something that was put the minimum machine. You take that away from them, they don't have to worry about that. They just concentrate on learning the tool that they actually come along to learn. Right, so that's all well and good. We've shown them a nice terminal that they can run on their machine. And you might say, well, so what? I could have TTY'd into the HPC and started running this stuff. Well, yes, you could. You might not have had the training material in that environment. So again, it's this coexistence of tools and the guidance in one nice container. You might have to move on to things you like. Now, this particular one of the course topics that came up that people wanted to get into was transcriptomics. So looking at messenger RNAs being produced by cells that have been run under different experimental conditions. So which genes get turned on, which ones get turned off, and how, you know, and sort of the ratio of whether or not there's an association between genes with pathways. So I found a nice DBI course. Admittedly, it was around zebrafish rather than how we're moving with you, but to an extent it got through the basic steps of RNA-seq. This idea about, again, all the things about aligning the sequences that you've got to a reference, whether your genes are on, counting the number of reads that map to a particular gene, an idea of the expression levels, and so on. And then doing some analysis. And again, so it's this. Yes, that's it. IFR-RNA-seq course. That container, that's got. Again, we're using a course data folder, which we can map to a different directory, obviously. And this uses this web preview that I mentioned earlier. So I have to have it already loaded. So instead of our ports, then we've now got this thing here with our preview. This bit also has interesting things on the kinematic. I'll start the container because it wasn't started, that's why I've got the things off. So there we go, so we've got web preview. What that actually shows is what's being offered on the port 80. There's a little diagram. Don't worry about that. That's in the middle. And again, we've got, in this instance, we only had a single volume. Because I was making things more complex in the compute environment, I thought I'd keep this side as simple as possible. So if I click on the web preview, I don't have either control C or control V, and what I've now got is a learn desktop, LXDE, and we're running notebooks. Now, if they wanted to use their own machine, they would, to get to that stage, they'd have had to know how to install Python, how to use PIP, etc., etc. And then have to know which bits they had to actually load in the IPython modules. Well, here, pretty much instantaneously, it's been configured and running on their machines. And again, I think one of the speakers yesterday, one of the universities said they used deployed notebooks this way, except they were using Jupyter Hub, which is quite a feature, which is also a really cool project.
So you've got the desktop inside of your web browser, is that right?
Sorry?
Is that the desktop inside your web browser?
Yeah.
Is there a reason why you didn't like just expose the IPython ports and get access to the IPython directly from?
Yeah. Basically, it worked out easily because we also wanted to use other things to roll within this environment. So it wasn't just that the, I mean, it's a browser within a browser, I admit, that didn't help. I must admit, when I go back to my materials for this particular unit, I'm going to go back and explain to people what's going on, because that did cause some issues with the computer, which browser they had to fit with. But then, there's another way to present. Okay, so this is trying to get another advantage of things like notebooks, which was the unification of the course material and the actual results as they work through. So they actually would go away with a version that had all the workings and they could see what the output were from the commands and so on. So it was a kind of living document for them. And again, you don't generally have to teach people how to use a web browser. Yeah? Has anyone ever had to teach someone how to use a web browser? So it's a very nice way of presenting training material. I made very major use of the input boxes. Usually something that people don't necessarily know how to run something. So present myself and do it. So, you know, you've got ints in and you have reveals, and those are just simple shell scripts that are outside. They don't need to know about that. So, it's this interactiveness again. Also, I don't like having to race around buttons and people saying, oh, you need to start this one, and down the trouble.
Have you printed one of those boxes in like my notebooks? I've never seen that before.
Well, what that is, you see, what that's doing, so I've got the exclamation there, that's going off and running shell commands. What I've got is, I've got a shell script and a browser.
Okay. I think that shell skip that rides that last.
And start, yeah.
That is not magic like marker.
No. I just went for a very simple shell script because I was getting them to use shell commands within their iPath notebook. So they weren't just using Python tools. They were using Python plus shell and other tools as well. You go down it. I mean, okay, we talked about bow tie, just think about aligning to the Gmail. This top hash, which does the alignment in this case, is a particular type of alignment tool because we're dealing with eukaryotic cells, so we've got introns to deal with when we actually take the message around and map that seems we've got a lag back there are some introns in between. So they get to use a tool, you can give them information about what the flags actually mean, and then go down into my Python box, input box, and just put them in. So, you know, they never actually, instead of this business of looking at your notes, going across typing, looking at notes, typing, etc. You actually have this, it's a nice environment. They actually appreciate it. And again, you can say, this is set, you're using an iPython notebook that was set up within your machine like that. You didn't have to install anything. You just had to click on an app in our Pragmatic App Store. So if you want to have a play with that, it does have the perennial problem, of course, about volumes, and there's a note at the start about how to do that. And this is why another reason why I didn't just expose it, because they actually have to use a shell, go into the shell and copy some files over. Because if you try and use this notebook, you won't get very far, because the output commands will try and write to that very thin top layer. And given you're dealing with genomic data, they will very soon saturate that level and so they have to sort of stop and start and make another copy of this notebook, and then you get to use the commands to actually launch a notebook viewer. Just scroll down to that. So if you want to get used to how they want a notebook server. Last time I was nice to them, this time I wasn't quite so nice, they had to copy them themselves. So they started using their command line skills. Obviously, that was launched in that direction, it uses the right of the volume, and all should be well in house. And you can do all the things you would normally do in a notebook as well. So if you want to sell notebooks to your users, if you can give them instantaneous environments on their personal machines, on their home machines, etc., so they've actually got the ability to engage with that tool in their own time, at their own pace. They don't have to do a lot of training machine with the environment, they can bring the training machine home effectively. So that was actually, one of our physicians really, really took to this and really enjoyed it. I started having concerns about him that he might have kind of abandoned his science and actually get into this. So it's a really, again, it's another good way of actually showing people notebooks, because they're actually using the notebook and not just being told it's wonderful, it's reproducible, it's etc., etc. Had students who were doing analysis, they're putting graphs and tools back into the notebook. So we showed them how to bring a graphic into a notebook. And they could then print that up to a PDF, give it to their supervisor, job done, who knows what parameters I used, what flags I used, this is my output, these are my error messages and logs, except all in one document. If you want, we can show them how to use the boxes to do text as well, so they can annotate. So,
I did this because I was thinking that I would have to deal with this particular outcome. Things like that. So you can you get the idea that they can capture their thoughts. So they're not just documenting commands they use, they're starting to document the reasons why they were using those commands. So somebody who came afterwards who was following that workflow would understand those decisions. They might disagree with it, but know what they at least know why. Oh, why are they using that parameter? You know, here, have a look. So again, it's a nice way of selling the fact that you can do good practices with your notebook. You can do bad practices with a notebook, but I don't take any responsibility for that. It gave them instantly this nice computer run, and that's the other thing, you can sell notebooks onto them, the fact that you've got this quite a powerful data science environment, bringing all the Python tools of data science. We got them also to do things like, obviously they could actually go into a file, they could do a shell command to look into a file for their results, and it would actually appear within that notebook as well, so they've got a capture of that. We did have to quickly teach them to use tape, otherwise, so they could look at the output statistics from the counts, so they're sort of counting all the different ways in which that RNA has been processed. So have I got different flavours of that the products that gene? We didn't want to pass. So if you want to have a go with that and have a little play, always bear in mind that's the first step. I would love it if there's a tool to set some of these volumes up within Pragmatic, but I suspect what you'll probably wind up doing is when we make the menu to the Docker for Windows and Docker for Mac, we'll have some kind of script that will do it, and that'll make it a lot easier for the users, especially as they begin. One thing I have done, I went back to a little script, so I have it implemented in here, it is intended to go in, which checks to see whether or not someone's mounted the volume locally. Because if you use QDF, the mounting changes. So you just write up a bit of script to sort of look for that, whether it be a Mac or a Windows, you just want to know that it's changed. You don't really care if it's mapped to it. You just know that it's changed from the original slash volume. So that's actually quite. Quite useful, and I'm going to work, incorporate that into the next revision of this to try and make things automatic. So rather than having the wrong one come up, you'll do a thing which says, you haven't had this, please just set the marks into the web page and do it that way. Make it a lot more friendly. But that's obviously the feedback. So, play. I don't need to play.
After your training courses, do you expect students to work, do the analysis in Docker, or go away and then use native Linux on
HPC? We have HPC, we have servers that they can often do bundling and so on. I've never actually suggested them that we're doing these on their laptops or on their desktops, unless they're not fairly powerful.
So it's just a means to get the Linux environment.
Yeah, they get used to the Linux environment, they get used to use the tools, and they get to use the tool a subset. So you're looking at a very window environment, so you've got only the tools that are involved in that process. So there's no distractions, there's no other wondrous things. They don't know which aligner they've got to use, you've given them a set. That one's got, it's a bit stacked, it's got star as well, so another aligner other than top, they're using an alternative top, so you can get them to do comparison, so they can do repeat that with a different tool, compare the output, so once you've captured the output, and go and flip between them and have a look and see whether or not, if that particular tool has discovered something different. But the idea is to get people familiar with the tools,
not the environment. We do show them, that we do tell them about Unity's documents. As you can see, it's, we show the advantages by actually teaching a subject. We're saying, now, we've been teaching good practice, you now know about notebooks, go and use notebooks. If you're doing a command line environment for a pipeline, come back to us and we'll show you how to build a Docker container, put that pipeline in. And then when you do your paper, you can have a DOI to the Docker Hub with your container. And that can be put in as part of your paper. So someone can immediately go off, pull that container, and relate to the tools and be using the same versions that you were using. I find that sometimes these tools change flags. For some weird mothers, next version just decide they're not using minus T anymore, they use another flag. And of course, that breaks your training tool. It's kind of a good way, because you're going to have to learn as you teach them that this is what real life is like. You've got to be prepared for people doing that and how to get help from tools. And that's the other thing. I mean, the thing that I find that people have the greatest difficulty with is getting help on a tool. And that's because standards are a wonderful thing, let's have lots of them. Do I use minus H, minus HH, minus help, minus question mark? Do I just type the command? You have to get them into this thought that you're going to have to work out what the author decided to use. And this is a nice play one to do that, they're not worried. The other thing is that you can get rid of the whoopsies without any dire consequences. If they do something that destroys the container, it's not your trading machine, you just pull the container back again, and they're off running. If you start to give people root access, you'll start learning how to install software and remove software. I would rather them do it in this than on a server. Would anyone disagree with that? So again, that's another way you can actually teach, you can sell that as a benefit, they can actually practice in an environment where it will blow up, you can give it back, no problems. I think, the CEO of Docker, he's got quite a distinct name. He demonstrated that once, a live demo. He started just deleting partitions, not really nearly, and just pulled it back. Very, very, very brave man in my book. But you can see here, we can use the training metaphor to show them a lot about containers and advantages. And you can push them gently, and I do mean gently, to the goal of actually having them adopt them. For things like publications, etc. And also packaging. I mean, as I said, we do have some servers, and I've persuaded one of our partitions that we've got a new server where it uses for analysis. We're doing a lot of Docker environments on there for things like Chime, etc. Just to actually make it available. And it also helps him. As I said, Chime's a bit of a brute to set up. That if you want to, if there's a new version coming, Chime 2, Summit Chime, and the ability to actually compartment out the different versions, and you can have a period of movement from one to the other. And if there are problems, people go, the other one's still there, it's completely segregated. We can move on like that, whereas if we were doing that on a conventional box, if it was expecting different versions of a lot of the dependencies, it would break one or the other. So it has operational things. If you've got people who want to provide services, then there are advantages to going down that particular route. If you're managing your own server, we do have a few of those boxes back. You can't stop them. You saw yesterday. Sinks are no barrier to building your servers. But we've got HPC,
we want people to use the agency for real analysis, but the fact that you can actually put this out on a container out in the hub as part of your publication, as was mentioned yesterday, if it's on a Docker container, there's plenty of cloud environments where you can run it. So you know, you're actually making your work more citable because people can actually reproduce it. You might get them something that actually they'll find useful in their own work as well, if it's all set up and it's working. As I said, some of these pipelines, and we have pipelines with R tools, Python tools, shell scripts, all those. And if you start thinking about when Matthew put up his slide yesterday with the castles, some of these pipelines, I mean, he was just doing one particular task, but some of these pipelines do a lot of different tasks, with a lot of different tools, with a lot of different dependencies. So you've already got quite a barrier there for somebody following your work and going through and repeating it. If you can sell Docker as a way of actually removing a lot of those barriers, which it does, it's not perfect, we already had talks pointed that out. Maybe singularity is a solution, we'll see. We'll go back and try it a bit different way. We can sort of promote that, and we promote it with this advance, so people are using it. And I think that's the key thing I want to come away with it. If you use this kind of approach, people use containers, and it just becomes, it's just like a word processor, just like an app on a phone, etc. It just becomes accustomed to it. It's not something special, it's not something new, it's not something threatening. You actually sell the ideas. And I think with that, perhaps we're going to need some coffee to begin the flag. But Bill Bowman is coming. If you want to play. Show you a few more environments as well. But I use the LXDE a lot now because I've got visualization tools. We got to the point where people have got to the point where they've done an analysis and they really wanted to get some nice visualization papers. So we then had to move into using other visualization tools. So we started using lots of R. Things that use digital blocks and the like to generate publication graphics. So that was a nice neat segue for us. Just happened to work that way in courses. And people with particularly programming courses are something that you start off with a particular objective, but along the way you think, well, actually, I'm not going to have to go look and smell a few flowers over here. And that's what happened. We actually had, because of the way we structure these things that we give them out to, we also can let the students decide where we go as well, what do they want to learn. And we can build the environments quite quickly. That's the other thing, it's easy to sell to trainers. So if you've ever had to hear about a bunch of learners who are using your training machines, you fast become a soldier and deliver something just restores like that. So we were using Docker with Kitematic to deliver training. Another thing that might be more dear to your heart if you're not a mathematician is the fact that you invariably wind up having to teach people how to use the command line to use some open source tools. And I came across what I thought was quite a useful Dockerized environment. And if you Google for Linux command line bootcamp, the first one that comes up is this Rick Smith. We use this. This is actually, he's set up on the web. But you can, if you go to the GitHub, you can get all the bits you need to run it on your own Linux server. And it uses something called Docker Browser, which generates all of this. And it uses something called Adventure Time. which is a bit like the old sort of text adventures in a way. But it lets you build course materials, and he did this thing that I found quite useful. So basically, it exposes a multi-pane browser window with the notes about what they're doing, and some sample output, a little terminal window up here that they can type commands into, and down here, which doesn't always work, I found, there's a little sort of file browser, so as you create directories, you can have a look at them that way. But it's not essential in my book anyway. And basically, it takes you through what I consider to be a very good grounding in the command line. And just stops short of writing scripts. So there's a lot of stuff to learn about piping commands together. And that's about the point where we like to take people up and start them to build bioinformatics pipelines, because they've actually learned this idea about taking out one Linux command and piping into another Linux command, which is obviously the fundamental building block. So up here, you can type commands in. The reason I've done it locally is that the response over there is not brilliant. He's actually using cloud to host this. He's passed it like cloud instance to run it. Yes, it's not being good. Unfortunately, I can't take you to my one because obviously our IT department starts like, well, no, you're not exposing that on the web. So it's behind our firewall. But if you follow the instructions on GitHub, you can actually set it up. If you've got a Linux server, you can install Docker on it, and then you install Docker browser, you pull down the Docker container that talks to the Docker browser, and you've got people to generate these web pages. And at some point I want to take this apart and actually start writing more advanced courses as well on scripting. And I think it'll be a very good way of doing it. It's one of those sorts of discoveries you make, a bit like Swellify, when you want to show people how to use R. It's a really good way of getting people in, leading them through. And you can drop the hint at the end. In fact, all this is sitting on the Docker container server. But it's, I assume everyone has to teach people at some point how to come on. I mean, is that the case? Your institutions, you want, wind up having to take people through the basics so they can actually get to where you want them to be. Is that a fairly fundamental key step? Yeah. So I recommend that as a resource. But as I said, the web response is awful, depends on the things. So I would have to say, follow the GitHub and build it on your local Docker installation or server. And you might have a response that's in control the traffic. But it's a very, it covers. So you start off with the dreaded LS, and they start getting into using things like Nano and Touch, so they're starting to build files and edit them. And as you see, sort of over eager, okay, next button, and things like that. The guy that talks about paths, second command variables, command environment variables. All nice basic stuff, all brought to them by our friend Docker. So I'm using Docker in that environment as well. So for training, I've used pretty much all the stuff now is in Docker in some form or another, either being provided by a server that's got things like this on it, or by containers that people download. Obviously, the disadvantage with this is it is a bit of a deal breaker at the moment for me is that I can't expose it to the web. I haven't tried it with the VPN, yeah, I ought to. If that's the case, then our staff and students can then use VPN to access it, and that would be just handy. So you'll have to research, if you do set this up, you'll have to research how people get to it from outside. It's just carry on. But I like it. And the people that I've, more importantly, not just I like it, but the people that I'm training like it, because it, again, it's self-paced. You know, they can work around their time schedules, not yours. So when you go to management centre, you've got to get rooms like this, etc. It's a nice use case. The other thing, how many people use Etherpad? Is anyone use Etherpad still?
Yeah.
I quite like it. It's a nice tool. I just want to find a public one. Again, I can't get you to lie one. But what I've done is, those that have used it, when you connect to an Etherpad server, you get this sort of dialogue. And it doesn't look like much when it loads, depending on what things they add onto it. But basically, it's a bit like Google Docs. People can connect to it over the web, they can start typing, and it's a live document. And it's quite good for things like brainstorming, quite useful if you're doing a course. You can have people put questions into it, and rather than have them interrupt the material while you're teaching, you can come to a safe break, go address the Etherpad, start going through those questions and dealing with them, and you know, it gives some structure. So there we go. You can put links in, so you can, if you want to have a course board, so you can tell them, oh, go connect to this container, or go to this link, pull the data, or pull the course documentation. You can embed all of that in there. It's got some things like bolding and underlining, italics, etc. Very basic text formatting. But what I do is I run this on Docker. So I've got an Etherpad Docker container that's sitting on that on the server that runs the command line bootcamp. We use that. Well, we've used it for courses. We also use it when we have informal bioinformatics meetings. So we can build agendas that way. We have it live before the meeting. People put up topics, so you can have a live agenda built up, and then you can go in and you can put notes in there when you're actually having your meeting. It's useful how you want. But again, you know, Docker makes it easy to set up. I've pretty much used the Etherpad that was on. Get out of the way, Gene. I mentioned something else. I do actually use Gene to do screen capture it. Sometimes it gets in the way. So I pretty much used the one that was there, but again, because you inherit it, should have just typed in that. Those who've used Etherpad, you'll know that you can have lots of add-ins. There they are. Do not do this. I have not stored the Docker file, I have not stored the GitHub to it. So basically, what I did is I took someone else's Etherpad implementation. It was more or less what I wanted. I used the Docker from, I added in the packages. Etherpad that did things like I wanted to use index lists of the meeting notes and the call slides at the start to give a little friendly intro to the server. So basically I customised it. But I didn't actually have to do the install to build Etherpad. I just pulled it. And again, yeah, and that is then available on people. So if they want to pull it, you can run it off of your, you don't have to run it off of your class server, you can pull it to machine with Pipematic, make that publish that. So if you're in a small group meeting, you can just make it available on your laptop. And obviously you're capturing the session. So again, that's another way of using an application to sell the concept of containers. So easy for them doing, and everyone set up their own one just like that. Without knowing how to do installs. It's commoditizing, basically, is the best way of putting it, really. So I find that also quite useful training, because it really does help. Because the other thing I mentioned yesterday was this idea, we're trying to move away from vertical learning. So you have a teacher, pupils, that goes. What you actually have is it goes all always, so it was horizontal as well. So there are, somebody might put up a question on the Etherpad. Before I've reached my breakpoint to say, let's go out and look at the Etherpad, somebody who's sussed out the answer has put the answer in. And that's a really good thing because that, yeah, it starts building this cohesion amongst your cohort. They start to know what people are interested in. They know, oh, Santa knows a bit of R. If I'm going to have a problem, I'll go and have a chat with them as well. So you're actually doing a social experiment going on within your class. You get people to sort of recognise their strengths. So again, you can point to that side. I use Docker that, and it really facilitates this kind of horizontal learning. So those are the general ways that I've been using containers at the Institute. Hopefully, you're seeing now. I mean, I don't make a secret that I'm using Docker, but to a large extent, people don't actually have to care. They just know it's there. They don't have to get to it. And I think that is the key to promoting container usage, is that you actually say, it's there, it works, you pull it, you go. And when we've shown, when Ocean's thing shows you the hideous command line things you have to get to run. And that really will, I mean, if you're gonna show people who've never done that kind of thing that, then quick tip, lock the doors, because they will run. I felt that when I was doing the software installation course. So the other thing you can do is I said about giving a safe root access to a Linux machine. I've modified slightly some containers that I found on Docker Hub that are desktop Linuxes. So again, using VNC to connect in to give you a graphical user interface desktop on your laptop or on your desktop machine. And in that, we've been teaching people how to install software. And as I said, that's actually quite valuable because a lot of software, you have to be root to install. Certainly in the early days, I liken it to a chimp playing with a hand grenade. It's not a case of if, but when, there's going to be an explosion of bits of chimp meat flying around. It is a potentially hazardous environment for beginners to actually work with, the fact that they can actually damage a server. So if you give them this kind of scratch box of a Docker container, you can build, you can give access to lots of different ones. So the stuff we've just done, I've got this Centos farm, so they get to use Yum, so they learn a particular package manager. We have a lot of Centos machines, our IT department likes Centos and Redpack, so you can give them an environment akin to what they might be using on a real server. You can give them Ubuntu, because we have a lot of packages that are much better supported in Ubuntu, and they can go into that and use that. The other thing we can do is we can say to people, you've got a server that's been provided by IT, it's running Red Hat. Okay, you want to run this. This is much better supported in Ubuntu. You know, the actual authors use based on that. We can give you a Docker container that's Ubuntu. You can map a drive, a folder to your CentOS machine. You can put software in that. It will not mess up your Red Hat machine. You won't be you can control the exposure of ports, so it's local to that machine. You can put it behind the firewall. You can use the package that suits your work on the infrastructure that's been provided for you that is sanctioned. So, you know, it's sort of a way for you to live in peace with your IT department. You can use the environment that you need to actually, with the tools you need, without, upsetting them. So you can start to show them, just because you've got CentOS machine doesn't mean you can't run Ubuntu and use the packages there. You can actually generate a machine that just does what you want, end of. But again, as I said, we can give them a safe environment they can do that in, like spinning up these containers on their laptops, they can go in, they can learn how to install packages, they can learn what goes wrong, which is an equally valuable thing, because it does go wrong. I think the primary candidate I can think of there are pip installs, where it throws up dependency and doesn't handle it gracefully or disgracefully. So you can actually let them experience those kind of things and not mess up a working system. So it's a safer, and that has benefit A, you're not going to trash a box. B, they're much more relaxed about doing it because they know they're not going to trash them. So you can present this as, again, another advantage of the container. Again, you're actually building this casebook and saying that they have a role within the organization. And it's just purely enjoying yourself. So that's those. As I said, your mileage may vary when you sort of lift containers. The particular one I chose with the CentOS does give you a nice desktop. So they do think, some people obviously do things where they decide they've got to have. Okay, so again, it's another way you can teach people in different environments, so you can have KDE desktops, you can have LXDE, all those, and you can familiarise people. And you might have had quite an involved software installed if you were doing that on a general purpose server. So you can set up all these environments to give people experience of using different systems. They can go out, they have that thing, oh yeah, I've used Node, I've used KDE, I've used LXDE. Again, it's a nice way of generating bespoke training instances that relate to environments that your learners are going to come into contact with. And as I say, it's one they can mess up and it's not going to be permanent. So, the first thing a lot of them had was, oh, where's the application going? Literally. The other things like that pull people up. The problem I had with this one was that the person who did it really went for a minimal thing. I mean, I'm equally guilty. I like to try and make my containers as small as possible. So you tend to trim out the guff, as we use an expression. You get rid of the things that you think, oh, I don't need. These guys possibly were a bit farther. There were no bank pages. The less command wasn't installed, things like that. All sorts of things that we'd already been training our users to expect in our Linux environment, again, like the talk yesterday. So I had to go back and I'm monkeying with the Docker file to restore all the things that they would expect. But that way they had a safe environment, they can learn how to use package installers that are relevant to different flavors of Linux, which is often the thing that people say, oh, I've got a Centos machine, how do I install that? How do I find the packages? How do I use that package? And you can actually build that learning environment and train people, build the material up, and you've got your training environment. So again, Docker goodness comes to the rescue. And it would be very difficult. You could do it with VMs. As I said though, if you did delete it, then you've probably got several gigabytes to copy back to restore it. So, I don't know that would be a winner. So, I mean, one other thing, I haven't put these under the overheads, but again, with our it's quite easy to find, again, this is the strength of the climatic search, is you can find all these kinds of environments. If you want to teach people about, God help us, how to run Windows programs on their Linux machine, you can take them straight to a Linux machine that's got Wine pre-configured, and you've got an environment where they can learn how to do that. I mean, people do the strangest things. If you go to Docker, you'll see there are so many images that you can quite happily waste your day just looking through what's available. But it's quite a richness. The other thing I would actually say is do a little bit of research with this. Go and have a look at various images and find good examples and bad examples. When you get to the point where you actually want to teach people, okay, I've sold you an idea of containers, I now want you to build a container. You need a few good and bad examples of practices. And you will find more on the Docker Hub, like you will find more on GitHub. I've just shown you, I've actually done more to go with mine. I've got one of my repositories does not have my usual minimal standard setup. That said, I mean, the idea is then you can actually show people real life examples, say, do it this way, don't do it that way, and then actually explain to them why. So the advantage of publishing your Docker file, that people can see,
what's inside it. It's not a black boxed environment. They can see what software you use, what configurations you use. The other thing you can do, there's an awful lot of open source software out there, isn't there? And you invariably, if you've got any particular application and you say, I want a package to do that, and you do a search, you'll find umpteen possibilities. The other way to sell Docker to these people who are in that situation is to get them to use, train them using a tool like this, get them to find containers with that application set up, or a set of applications, and let them go in and try it. They can try it with their real data, they can map their volume, they can use the tool and say, yes, no, it doesn't do what I want. Without going through the process of installing that on their Linux box, and then having to uninstall it in their Linux box, because it doesn't actually meet their criteria. And then, if they follow the good practice of publishing their Docker file, you can go back into that Docker file and find out a recipe for a native install that works. Yeah? That's often worth it. You've got this sort of, there's a certain level of discipline when you craft a good Docker file. Commenting always is nice, not always. So you can actually go back to it again. It's another way of selling it, saying, well, okay, you want to try this. Do you know that it's actually going to do what you want? Okay, try Docker, try putting a container, try it with your data, see if it suits. Try before you buy. But if you've done the training, they've got this tool to go and explore the containers to see whether it suits. So you can build lots of return benefits on some simple courses using a simple tool like that. I do want to actually go back and use Docker and Windows and Docker Mac and do all this stuff again, to be honest, in readiness for to see how it works. There are failings within Pragmatic, but I do actually like this. This is worth money. It was worth buying Pragmatic. It is a nice interface for people who actually find the containers they want to use. So I think I'll just go to the conclusion now and let them play. I want to throw this out to you now, really. What about your experiences? When you've introduced people to containers, how has it gone? Are there things that you found work or don't work? Anyone? Have you tried sort of satirizing your choice of containers?
So, we use it to give tools to biologists on their Windows machines, and we've just got little shell scripts. So, sort of got a tool back, toolbox, you get bash.
Yeah.
So, we just have bash script called that build Docker image, and then another one say run analysis, and that's it.
Yeah,
and
then, so just turning handle.
Yeah, and then you come into that, drops you into an interactive Docker session, and it says, this is the script that you need to run, and this is where they need to be. You need to, so in the repository that we pull down, we have a data directory saying, you need to put the data here, and when you run the script inside the Docker, the app will go be in the admin directory. So that's all in the readme file, and that works fine. I sit down next to them the first time, and then it works. If they come back to 6 months later, then they probably contact me again. But as if they're working on the continuously, it's fine.
So, one of the things that I want to go back on the bike size and do is I want to do a lot of screencasting and videos so that I can improve to my learning environment. So we don't get those kind of return visits. If they go off for a few months and think, how do
this impact method, or how do I, you know, I'm in this particular learning environment and I don't know how to do this, you know, I'm in these areas. It's actually, you know, I want to try and remove myself from the equation so I can spend time on other material, because there is an awful lot of material that I've got to cover. Are they happy? I mean, you know, is that your feeling? They come back to, yeah, it's easy to use, it does what I want.
I mean, they're happy because I made a script that saves them hours, so it doesn't matter like that they have to learn some arcane things in some terminal that they don't understand, as long as it gives them something valuable. So,
yeah. But maybe like a nice button, like that somebody showed me the other day, you know, click here to start it. Anyone else? Are you the lone crusaders of containers within your organisations, or are you supporting people who are running your tools and containers? Is that any of those use cases out there? A lot of the things like text mining software is written in by R. It's just obviously that level of arcaneness to the average, you know, punter who walks in every day. You've got to think about balance of training, I presume, as far as you don't want to take on too much of that side. Okay. Have any of you used Docker to actually do the training? Have you thought about doing that? I mean, I'll be presenting it, but I mean...
I was going to use it just to have an iPython notebook, but at the time in the training suite, they were running Windows 7. So I think when they installed it, but that one function box, you had to click some checkbox to get the right file system, and
I might be able to try and dock it for Windows. If you're not using VirtualBox or anything else on those machines, I'll just lay that one out here. That's a bit of a blow when I discovered that. I was less than happy because I do use. I don't know about your machine, but my machine, I've had to stick lots of memory in because I'm running lots of virtual machines all the time. It's just a way of getting the job done. Anyone else thought about using training? I mean, you can capture an awful lot. You can do things, you can sort of, you can build this sort of living training material, and then you can update it. And then when they call that container, it's the updated version. So again, you're keeping things fresh. My ascertainment with the Vitamax training material is that things change. They are disruptive technologies. It's a variety. I mean, sometimes it's a tool. If it's a GUI tool, people change menu, people change buttons. You really would not believe. Sometimes it looks a really subtle thing. It will trick the learner if your material says, oh, go and click on the tick box on this particular pane, and they've moved it off to another pane. You have to go back and update your training material, and you have to ensure then your learning environment is with that version as well. So, it's double-edged sword. I mean, screencasts also, as a result, go out of date. If you look on YouTube and you look for some of the more older versions where people are talking about things like OpenShot, the video editor. Things changed there. They've had features removed and brought back again, things like that. And so there's a limited shelf life to a lot of the screencasting and videos. It's a real pain. But it's true, also the written notes, as I said, especially the BCF Tools, I think it was, it was just a point of vision, and it changed some of the command flags. Just behave. I didn't like minus T anymore. Or to use minus F. On the author's point, which of course then messed up training material that you had to go back and change it. And that was a command line tool, which I
completely
So are there any other projects you have in ShopShadowLink? Do you showcase applications? So you build an application and say, it's here. I mean, you're probably a prime example of that. You build an application in a container and you make it available. But anyone else doing that?
So I don't think it has a container involved in it, but the Open Science Framework is something that I started using recently, and I'm finding it a really helpful tool to coordinate team members using all the same files, and there's a kind of version control in there. You can combine it with GitHub and Google Docs and a bunch of other programs as well. So it seems like that could be a good space to incorporate Docker. I don't know how to do that, but you probably do. And it's something that people are adopting really rapidly.
And also, if you want to do things like data carpentry or software carpentry courses, if you want to run those, you can build Docker environments that people can then effectively be using off-site. They don't have to configure software to actually run that training material. So, you know, you're actually upscaling the value of those course materials, because anyone can use them anywhere at that point. They don't need a Linux machine, they don't need a Linux machine configured in a particular way with a set of training materials. They can just put it. It's just there. Think about it. I mean, I like to go away and actually think about things like taking it in as a way. As I said, it's a Trojan horse. You know, they don't. You're not getting them to think about them as containers. They're just tools. And if a tool is good, people will use it. The other thing was, I've been using a variety of things here. I mean, if you go through the GitHub, you'll find other things that I've used. So the Etherpad, the notebooks, etc. If anyone's got any other ideas or tools that they've encountered that might use, I mean, some of them I haven't had to do anything with because providing an RStudio environment, for example, there are RStudio containers in the hub. I could then just run Swellify, just start getting to grips with R. They're things that are not necessarily things you can build as a doctor, but actually then become available because you've given them an environment that they can run. So if anyone's got any ideas of those. Think back to the stuff, just in case you want to go. That's okay. One version. Okay, my email address is mark.fernandez@quadrum.ac.uk, as in up in the if you go to that site, you should have search. A scary picture. Find some tree. It's almost like you're doing it.
Thanks for waiting.
So yeah, they'll have my contact details with them as well. Should do. As you can see, I get involved in a variety of other activities in average. So I think that's just about where I want to stop. Hopefully, I've given you a flavour of the ways in which we've used training to introduce the concept of containers to people and, you know, get them thinking about using them in their day-to-day work. I think that's all that's actually required. I mean, if you try and hammer it into people, I find that they quickly turn off. Whereas if you give them a tool that they can use and is useful to them, has value, then you've sold them. And I've had people go away wanting to use some of the containers that I provided them to actually go and do analyses. And I said, well, actually, I wouldn't do that because you're limited by the machine you're running it on. But by all means, you know, you've learned the tools, you know how to drive those tools from those environments. Go to the HPC, start using those commands in the HPC. You know what they do, you know what secrets you've got to put them in, you know what the error messages need, etc. So you are set up to go into the next stage. But I mean, yeah, people have done it. They've gone off and done little, sort of looked at smaller subsets of the data.
Yep.
Have you tried Conda? I think it's especially for command line programs. It's quite useful because it's cross platform and
Conda?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, that's fine. There's one of the package managers we used when we were showing people. There's a Bioconda,
yes.
Which we'll install. I'm not entirely sold on Bioconda yet. I think that their repository needs a bit of work because there are multiple instances of the same software. And you know, you look at it and say, oh, it's so many thousand, but in fact, a lot of those are effectively duplicate. So I think it needs a bit of work on the repository. That's the nice thing about the Docker Hub. It's actually quite a good way of having metadata about what the containers do and who's providing them, etc. You know, all that kind of information about how active is the project. But yeah, it's got a lot of useful environments for bioinformatics, and it's using Maven, isn't it, to sort of partition off the applications as well. So if you do want to use different versions, you can effectively separate them. Once we'd locked the doors, we did show them a variety of the package managers. And, some of them wanted to run, but they couldn't. That is the thing. Coming from the Windows environment, a lot of people just used to a setup program that was click and away they go. You have to introduce them to the real world as far as Linux is concerned. That is very rarely the case. Sometimes you get lucky, somebody like someone to really install to. It's a godsend. But now, and I've taken through starting from things like tarballs that have been gzipped, that are actually executables. That's the way the authors decided to distribute their package through to things like pip installs, apt-gets, yums. Brew, the list goes on. And that's, again, it's usually about these kind of environments to do it in, because often they're completely unaware that there are all these different alternatives. And they need to make a decision that I'm on this type of system, I'm going to go down this particular route. Or if I go down the brew route, I may find that there aren't recipes for the package that I want. You'd have to work hard. I must admit, the bio packages for brew are fairly broad. Some of the scripts aren't very
where sometimes you have to force things to actually, or like you have some type of force at the game. And that's another thing you teach people, that you know, it should go this way, but you may, your mileage may vary. And there are ways of doing it, but with the risk associated that you might, you know, change the installation. But yeah, Tom's good. It's just another one, isn't it? I'm trying to get myself happy with brew. It seems to address a lot of the problematics issues, but I know obviously there are going to be other package managers that are better equipped. We've shown the one within R as well. Have you seen a new person's response to installing packages in R? All this output starts scrolling up as it pulls in GZIP files and starts building them and the rest of it. That's worth filming sometimes because they're looking at what's happened to my machine. And again, you know, training environment, you get to do a couple of packages and get used to it, okay. And you tell them you can turn it off, but I then tell them I wouldn't do it because if anything goes wrong, at least you know. You can spot the warning and go Google them and see what's going on. But the fact that you know you do need these advice to teach people how to install packages as well. Again, it's the same thing. If they screw it up, it doesn't matter. They're not going to have a systems admin jumping up and down. I give you root privileges and you go and do that. They can learn the skills in a safe environment. And they feel confident because they're the same. Yep.
I'm surprised that the slides come out to be mentioned earlier in this workshop, because there's certainly overlap with what we're trying to achieve with Conda and Docker in terms of why people have got a sandbox with which they can manage their own software stacks, and there's ways of sort of tracking pens between packages, both in sort of packaging set languages and power languages. So I think I quite like Conda for many reasons, but I see this thing as perhaps being complementary.
Yeah.
I found although Conda wants to be software agnostic, it's not. I've got people found that when you try to create a Conda environment, export the state of that using standard Conda tools, handle those things got different OS, but actually the specification environment actually includes OS specific packages. So you think that you've got a workflow which will work on Windows, Linux, and OS X using Conda, and it doesn't, because it requires your specification requires libraries which maybe don't exist on Windows. So I perhaps see Conda as being a nice thing that you use within Docker containers to set up software stacks, actually.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not always built from source.
I'm not working with Conda only on Linux. But it's been really useful because you don't need the root users are free to try things, so you create isolated environments. They can try things out without breaking a central installation, for example.
Certainly, it's something useful to do 600 work. Very nice tracking in common people. So, go away, you'll end up like in home directory. There's no need for any kind of elements, there's nothing to be setting up by 600. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that is the thing. I mean, another thing we're showing in things like Pipematic is the realization that if they do have a research pipeline that they put up on Docker Hub, is that suddenly the potential audience that could run that has grown. It doesn't matter whether they're running Linux, doesn't matter whether they're running Mac, doesn't matter whether they're running Windows. They can pull that pipeline, it will run. It might not run as fast as you might like, but it will run. You know, that environment will perform. So you know, that I think that's actually, you know, as far as broadening your potential audience for your work, is a good sell. So any other sort of tools that you've been sort of playing around with at the moment? Yeah? I'm quite happy to use package managers in my Docker files. I mean, you do learn tricks about making clear up, like the apt-get always clearing up the var partition, because before it like finishes finalizing that layer, and that helps you shrink the container. Because then you don't know all the guts and
going. But then also, yeah, there are consequences of that if you want to update afterwards, because you have to do a YAML update before you do the next get. That get update before you do the next. So it's a trouble going to impact times before you do the next app get install. But you did, that's another reason for going and looking at other people's Docker files. You learn these tricks about how you can minimize the number of layers and the size of those layers to actually compact your apps. And that's, so they actually load faster. Which if you're in a training environment, you want to see, I'm off, I'm ready to go. Okay, well, I think they're supposed to have, is it lunch at 12 or is it 12:30? Who's got an agenda handy? Let me check. Are we going to upset the Rosetta people again? We'll get back right there. So, yeah, please go and play. Pragmatic's quite good what it is. It's a nice, easy self-feed. Is it?
Lunch is being unpacked.
Oh, right. I won't stop you from your lunch. But I mean, yeah, it's all there. Like with our students, you pick those containers up and play with them and see what's been going on. And I dare say it's a lot that there are going to be people out here that can actually write better than me. And I've adopted writing documentation for about just a year and a half now, so I'm sure there are things I can still keep. Thank you.